professional photography. Pan over to the right to like a little theater. Oh, good. You got another one.
Yes, I have tricks in my pocket, I have things up my sleeve, but I am the opposite of the stage magician. He gives you illusion that has the appearance of truth. I give you truth in the pleasant disguise of illusion. To begin with, I take you back to an alley in St. Louis. I reverse time to that quaint period, the 30s. When the huge middle class of America was matriculating in a school for the blind, their eyes had failed them, or they had failed their eyes. So they were having their fingers pressed forcibly down on the fiery braille alphabet of a dissolving economy. In Spain, there was revolution. Here, there was only shouting and confusion and labor disturbances, sometimes pretty violent, in otherwise peaceful cities such as Chicago, Cleveland, St. Louis. That is the social background of this play. The play is memory. Being a memory play, it is dimly lighted, it is sentimental, it is not realistic. In memory, everything seems to happen to music. That explains the fiddle and the wings. I am the narrator of the play and also a character in it. The other characters are my mother Amanda and my sister Laura, and a gentleman caller who appears in the final scenes. He is the most realistic character in the play, being an emissary from a world of reality that we were somehow set apart from. But having a poet's weakness for symbols, I am using this character also as a symbol. He is the long-delayed but always expected something that we live for. There is a fifth character in the play who doesn't appear other than this photograph hanging on the wall. This is our father, who left us a long time ago. He was a telephone man who fell in love with long distance. And so he gave up his job with the telephone company and skipped a light fantastic out of town. The last we heard from him was a picture postcard from the Pacific coast of Mexico, containing a message of two words. Hello. Goodbye. And no address.
You know, Laura, I had the funniest experience in church last Sunday. The church was very crowded except for one pew way down front, and that was just this one little woman. Well, I smiled very sweetly at her, and I said, excuse me, would you mind if I shared this pew? I certainly would, she said. This space is rented. Do you know that is the first time I ever knew that the Lord rented space? These Northern Episcopalians, I can understand the Southern Episcopalians, but these Northern ones, no. Oh, honey, don't push your food with your fingers. If you must push your food with something, the thing to use is a crust of bread. You must chew your food before you swallow it down. Animals have secretions in their stomachs that enable them to digest their food without mastication. But human beings must chew their food and chew. Eat leisurely. A well-cooked meal has many delicate flavors that must be held in the mouth for appreciation, not just gulped down. And chew. Don't you want to give your salivary glands a chance to function?
Mother, I haven't enjoyed one bite of my dinner because of your constant directions on how to eat it. And you that makes me hurry through my meals with your hawk-like attention, every bite I take is disgusting. All this discussion of animal secretion, salivary glands, mastication.
Temperament like a metropolitan star. You are not excused from this table.
Now I'm getting a cigarette.
You smoke too much.
Oh, Mother, let me bring in the coffee.
No. You sit down. No. I'm going to be the colored boy today. You're going to be the lady.
How are you?
Resume your seat. You keep yourself fresh and free for your gentlemen callers.
I'm not expecting any gentlemen callers.
Well, the nicest thing about them is they come when they're least expected. Well, I remember one Sunday afternoon in Blue Mountain when your mother was a girl.
I know what's coming now.
Yes, but let her tell it.
Again?
She loves to tell it.
I remember one Sunday afternoon in Blue Mountain when your mother was a girl. She received 17 gentlemen callers. Well, sometimes there weren't chairs enough to accommodate them all, and we had to send the colored boy over to the parish house to fetch the folding chairs.
How did you entertain all these gentlemen callers?
Well, I happened to understand the art of conversation.
Oh, I bet you could talk.
Well, I could. All the girls in my day could, I tell you.
Yeah.
Wasn't enough for a girl to be possessed of a pretty face and a graceful figure, although I wasn't slighted in either respect. She also needed to have a nimble wit and a tongue to meet all occasions.
What did you talk about?
Well, things of importance going on in the world. Never anything common or coarse or vulgar. My callers were gentlemen all. Some of the most prominent men in the Mississippi Delta. Planters and sons of planters. There was young Champ Laughlin. He later became the vice president of the Delta Planters Bank. And Hadley Stevenson. He drowned in Moon Lake. My goodness, he certainly left his widow well provided for. $150,000 in government bonds. And the Couture brothers. Wesley and Bates. Bates was one of my own bright particular bulbs. But he got in a quarrel with that wild Wainwright boy and they shot it out on the floor of the Moon Lake Casino. Bates was shot through the stomach. He died in the ambulance on the way to Memphis. He certainly left his widow well provided for. 8 to 10,000 acres, no less. He never loved that woman. She just caught him on the rebound. My picture was found on him the night he died. Oh, and that boy that every girl in the Delta was setting a cap for. That beautiful, brilliant young Fitzhugh boy from Green County.
What did he leave his widow?
He never married. What is the matter with you? You sound as though all my admirers had turned up their toes to the daisies.
Well, isn't this the first you've mentioned that still survives?
He made an awful lot of money. He went up north to Wall Street and made a fortune. He had that Midas touch. Everything that boy touched just turned to gold. And I could have been Mrs. J. Duncan Fitzhugh, mind you. But what'll I do? I just went out of my way and picked your father.
Mother, let me clear the table.
Oh, no, dear. You study your typewriter chart or practice your shorthand a little. You keep yourself fresh and pretty. It's almost time for our gentlemen callers to start arriving. How many do you suppose we're going to entertain this afternoon?
I don't believe we're going to receive any, Mother.
Not any? Not one? Why, you must be joking. Not one gentleman caller? What's the matter? Has there been a flood or a tornado?
No, it isn't a flood. It's not a tornado, Mother. I'm just not popular like you were in Blue Mountain.
Mother's afraid I'm going to be an old maid.
Practicing your typing, I suppose.
Yes.
Deception, deception, deception.
How was the DAR meeting, Mother?
The DAR meeting.
Didn't you go to the DAR meeting, Mother?
No, I didn't go to any DAR meeting. I didn't have the strength. I didn't have the courage. I just wanted to find a hole in the ground, crawl into it, and spend the rest of my entire life there.
Well, why did you do that, Mother?
Why? Why? How old are you, Laura?
Mother, you know my age.
I was under the impression that you were an adult, but evidently I was very much mistaken.
Please don't stare at me, Mother.
What are we going to do? What is going to become of us? What is our future?
Well, Mother, has something happened? Has something happened, Mother?
I'll be all right in a minute. I'm just bewildered by life.
Mother, I wish that you would tell me what's happened.
I went to the DAR meeting. As you know, I was to be inducted as an officer. I stopped off at Rubikim's Business College to tell them about your cold and find out how you were progressing down there.
Oh.
Yes. Oh, oh, oh. I went straight to your typing instructor and I introduced myself as your mother. She didn't even know who you were. Wingfield, she said, I don't believe we have any such scholar enrolled in this school. Well, I assured her she did. I said, my daughter Laura's been coming to classes here since early January. Well, she said, I don't know unless you mean that terribly shy little girl who dropped out of school after a few days' attendance. Oh, no, I said, I don't mean her. I mean my daughter Laura, who's been coming to classes here every single day for the past 6 weeks. Excuse me, she said. And she took down the attendance book. And there was your name, unmistakable, printed with all the dates you'd been absent. I still told her she was wrong. I still said, oh no, there must have been some mistake. There must have been some mix-up in the records. No, she said, I remember her perfectly now. She was so shy and her hands trembled so that she couldn't touch the right keys. When we gave a speed test, she broke down completely. Got sick at the stomach and had to be carried to the washroom. After that, she never came back. We telephoned the house every single day and never got any answer. That must have been while I was working all day long down at that department store demonstrating those... I got so weak I couldn't stand up. I had to sit down while they got me a glass of water. $50 tuition. Oh, I don't mind the money so much, but all my hopes for any kind of future for you just gone up the spout. Just gone up the spout like that. Oh, Laura, don't do that. Don't play that controller. What have you been doing every day when you've gone out of the house pretending you were going to business college?
I've just been going out walking.
Oh, that's not true.
Yes, it is, Mother. I just went walking.
Walking? Walking in winter, deliberately caught in pneumonia in that light coat? Where did you walk to, Laura?
All sorts of places, mostly in the park.
Even after you started catching that cold?
It was the lesser of two evils, Mother. I couldn't go back there. I threw up on the floor.
From 7:30 till after 5 every day, you mean to tell me that you walked around in the park so that I would think you were still going to Rubicam's business college?
It wasn't as bad as it sounds. I went inside places to get warmed up.
Inside where?
I went in the art museum and the birdhouses at the zoo. I visited the penguins every day. Sometimes I did without lunch and went to the movies. Lately, I've been spending most of my afternoons in the jewel box, the big glass house where they raise the tropical flowers.
You did all that to deceive me. Just for deception. Why?
Mother, when you get disappointed, you get that awful suffering look on your face like that picture of Jesus' mother in the museum.
Hush!
I couldn't face it. I couldn't.
So, what are we going to do now, honey, with the rest of our lives? Just sit down in this house and watch the parades go by? Amuse ourselves with the Glass Menagerie and eternally play those worn-out records that your father left us as a painful reminder of him? Well, we can't have a business career. No, we can't do that. That just gives us indigestion. What is there left for us now but dependency all our lives? I tell you, Laura, I know what happens to unmarried women who aren't prepared to occupy a position in life. I have seen such pitiful cases in the South. Barely tolerated spinsters living on some brother's wife or sister's husband, tucked away in a mousetrap of a room. Encouraged by one in-law to go on, visit the next in-law. Little bird-like women. Without a nest, eating the crust of humility all their lives. Is that the future we have mapped out for ourselves? Because I swear I don't see any other alternative. And I don't think that's a very pleasant alternative. Of course, some girls do marry. My goodness, Laura, haven't you ever liked some boy?
Yes, Mother, I liked one once.
You did?
I came across his picture a while ago.
He gave you his picture, too?
No, it's in the yearbook.
Oh, a high school boy.
Here he is in the Pirates of Penzance.
The what?
The operetta the senior class put on. He had a wonderful voice. I sat across the aisle from him Mondays, Wednesdays, and Fridays in the auditorium. Here he is with the silver cup for debating. See his grin?
So so he had a grin, too.
He used to call me Blue Roses.
Blue Roses, why do you call your silly name like that?
When I had that attack of pleurosis, he asked me what was the matter when I came back. I said pleurosis, and he thought I said Blue Roses. So that's what he always called me after that. Whenever he'd see me, he'd holler, "Hello, Blue Roses!" I didn't care for that girl he went out with, Emily Meisenbach. Emily was the best-dressed girl at Soldon, but she never struck me as being sincere. I read in a newspaper once that they were engaged. It's a long time ago. They're probably married by now.
Well, that's all right, honey. That's all right. That doesn't matter. Little girls who aren't taught after business careers sometimes end up married to very nice young men. And I'm just going to see that you do that, too.
But, Mother...
What is the matter now?
I'm crippled.
Oh, don't say that word. How many times have I told you never to say that word? You are not crippled. You just have a slight defect. Now, if you lived in the days when I was a girl, and they had these long, graceful skirts sweeping the ground, why, it might have been considered an asset. When you've got a slight disadvantage like that, you just have to cultivate something else to take its place. You've just got to cultivate charm, or vivacity, or charm. That's the only thing your father had plenty of. Charm.
After the fiasco at Rubicam's Business College, the idea of getting a gentleman collar for my sister Laura began to play a more and more important part in my mother's calculations. It became an obsession. Like some archetype of the universal unconscious, the image of the gentleman collar haunted our small apartment. And even at home rarely passed without some allusion to this image, this specter. Even when his name wasn't mentioned, his presence hung in my mother's preoccupied look and my sister's frightened, apologetic manner. It hung like a sentence passed upon the wing fields. But my mother was a woman of action as well as of words. She began to take the logical steps in the planned direction. Late that winter and early spring, realizing that extra money would be needed to properly feather the nest and plume the bird, she began a vigorous campaign on the telephone, roping in subscribers to one of those magazines for matrons called the Homemaker's Companion, a type of journal that features serialized sublimations of ladies of letters who think in terms of delicate cup-like breasts, thin, tapering waists, rich, creamy thighs, eyes like wood smoking autumn, fingers that soothe and caress like soft, soft strains of music. Bodies as powerful as Etruscan sculpture.
Ida Scott, this is Amanda Wakefield. Well, we missed you at the DAR last Monday. Now first, how is your sinus condition? Why, you're just a Christian martyr, that's what you are. You are just a Christian martyr. Well, I was going through my little red book and I saw that your subscription to the Companion is about to run out just when that wonderful new serial by Bessie May Harper is starting. It's the first thing she's written since Honeymoon for Three. Now that was unusual, wasn't it? Why, Ida, this one is even lovelier. It's all about the horsey set on Long Island. And this debutante is thrown from her horse while she's taking him over the jumps at the regatta. Her span is injured. That's what the horse did, he stepped on her. And there's only one surgeon in the whole entire world who can keep her from being completely paralyzed, and that is the man she is engaged to be married to. And he is tall, and he's blonde, and he's handsome. Now that's unusual too, huh? Oh, no, he's not perfect. No, of course he has a weakness. Well, in fact, he has the most terrible weakness in the entire world. He drinks too much. What? Oh, no, honey, don't let him burn. You go take a look in the oven and I'll hold on. Why, that woman. Do you know what she did? She just hung up on me.
Shh. Oh, Mother, Tom's trying to write.
Oh, so he is. So he is.
Now, what are you up to?
I'm trying to save your eyesight. You only have one pair of eyes. You might as well take care of them.
Mother.
Now, I know Milton was blind, but that was not what made him a genius.
Mother, please go busy yourself with something else I'm trying to write.
Why can't you sit up straight so your shoulders don't poke through like sparrow's wings?
Mother, please, go busy yourself with something else. I'm trying to write.
Now, I have seen a medical chart. And I know what that position does to your internal organs. Now you sit up straight and I'll show you. Now, your stomach presses against your lungs press against your heart, and your poor little heart gets so discouraged because it hasn't got any room left to go on beating for you.
What in hell am I supposed to do?
Oh, don't you talk to me like that. What is the matter with you? Have you gone out of your senses?
Yes, I have. You've driven me out of here.
What is the matter with you, lady?
Look!
Big idiot!
Look, Mother, I haven't got a thing, not a single thing left in this house to call my own!
Lower your voice!
Yesterday you confiscated my books. You had the nerve!
I did. I took that horrible novel back to the library. That awful book by that insane Mr. Lawrence. I have no control over the output of a diseased mind or those people who cater to them. But I will not allow such filth in this house.
House!
No.
House? Who makes a slave of himself to keep the rent going? Who pays the rent?
Don't you dare talk to me like that.
No! I mustn't say anything. I just gotta keep quiet and let you do all the talking.
Let me tell you something.
I don't want to hear anymore.
You will hear more.
Well, I'm not gonna listen. I'm going
you
out.
You will listen to me, Tom Wingfield. I am tired of your impudence. And another thing, I'm right at the end of my patience.
What do you think I'm at the end of, Mother? Aren't I supposed to have any patience to reach the end of? Oh, I know. I know. It seems unimportant to you what I'm doing, what I'm trying to do, having a difference between them. You don't think that.
I think you are doing things that you're ashamed of, and that's why you act like this. I don't believe you go every night to the movies. Nobody goes to the movies night after night. Nobody goes to the movies in their right mind goes to the movies as often as you pretend to. People don't go to movies at nearly midnight, and movies don't let out at 2 a.m. Coming, stumbling, muttering to yourself like a maniac. You get 3 hours sleep and then go to work. Oh, I can picture how you're doing down there. Moping, doping, because you're in no condition to do a
That's
job.
That's true. That's very, very true. I'm in no condition.
How dare you jeopardize your job? Jeopardize our security. How'd you think we'd manage?
Look, Mother, you think I'm crazy about the warehouse? You think I'm in love with the Continental Shoemakers? You think I want to spend 65 years of my life down there in that Celtex interior with fluorescent tubes? Honest to God, I'd rather somebody picked up a crowbar and batted out my brains than go back, honest, but I go. Sure, every time you come in yelling that bloody rise and shine, I think, how lucky dead people are. Well, I go for $65 a month. I give up all I dream of being and doing ever, and you say that is all I think of? Oh, God. My mother, if self was all I thought of, I'd be where he is. Gone.
Tom.
As far as the system of transportation reaches.
Please don't grab at me, Mother.
I am not grabbing at you. I want to know where you're going now.
I'm going to the movies.
Oh, I don't believe that lie.
No? Well, you're right. For once in your life, you're right. I'm not going to the movies. I'm going to opium dens, Mother. Yes. Opium dens. Dens of vice and criminals' hangouts, Mother. I've joined the Hogan gang.
I'm a hired assassin. I carry a Tommy gun in a violin case. I run a string of cat houses in the valley. They call me Killer. Killer Wingfield. I'm really leading a double life. By day, I'm an honest warehouse worker, but at night, I'm a dynamic czar of the underworld. I go to gambling casinos and spin away fortunes on the roulette table.
I wear a patch over one eye and a false mustache.
Sometimes, I wear green whiskers. On those occasions, they call me a Diablo. Oh! I can tell you things to make you sleepless. My enemies are planning to dynamite this place some night. Some night, they're gonna blow us all sky high! And will I be glad? Will I be happy? And so will you be. You'll go up, up of a blue mountain on a broomstick with 17 gentlemen collars. Oh. You ugly, babbling old witch.
Oh, my Glass Menagerie!
I will never speak to you again as long as you live unless you apologize to me.
What are you doing?
Looking for a door key.
Where have you been all this time?
I have been to the movies.
All this time at the movies?
It was a very long program. And there was a Garbo picture and a Mickey Mouse. And a travelogue, and a newsreel, and a preview of coming attractions. And there was an organ solo and a collection for the Melt Fund simultaneously, which ended in a terrible fight between a fat lady and an usher.
Did you have to stay through everything?
Of course. Oh, I forgot. There was a big stage show. The headliner on the stage show was Malvolio the Magician. He performed many tricks, such as pouring water back and forth between pitchers. First it turned to wine, and then it turned to beer, and then it turned to whiskey. I know it was whiskey it finally turned into, because he needed people to come up out of the audience. And I came up, both shows. Kentucky straight bourbon. A very generous fellow. He gave souvenirs. He gave me this. This is his magic scarf. You can have a law. You wave it over a canary cage, and you get a bowl of goldfish. You wave it over a goldfish bowl, and they fly away canaries. But the wonderfulest trick of all was the coffin trick. We nailed him into a coffin, and he got out of that coffin without removing one nail. There is a trick that will come in handy for me. Get me out of this 2x4 situation.
Tom, shh.
What are you shushing me for?
You ain't mother.
Goody, goody. Pay it back for all those rise and shines. No. Don't take much intelligence, Lord. Get yourself into an Amber coffin. But
Who in the hell ever got himself out of one? Without removing one layer.
Me, it's her that's not speaking.
But if you just say you're sorry, she'll start speaking.
Her not speaking, is that such a tragedy?
Please, please.
Laura, are you going to go out and do what I asked you to do, or do I have to get dressed and go out myself?
I'm going as soon as I get on my coat. Butter and what else?
Just butter. Tell them to charge it.
Oh, they make such faces when I do that.
Sticks and stones can break our bones, but the expression on Mr. Garfinkel's face won't harm us. Tell your brother's coffee's getting cold.
Tom, do what I ask, will you? Will you, Tom?
Laura, either go now or don't go at all.
I'm going. Ow! Oh!
Laura?
Oh, my goodness.
Oh, I'm all right. I slipped, but I'm all right.
I tell you, if anybody falls and breaks a leg on this fire escape, that landlord ought to be sued for every cent he... Who are you?
Sorry, Mother. Sorry for all those things I said. I didn't mean it. I apologize.
My devotion has made me a witch, and so I make myself hateful to my children.
No, you don't.
I worry so much I don't sleep. It makes me nervous.
I understand that.
You know I've had to put up a solitary battle all these years, but you're my right-hand bower. Now, don't fail me. Don't fall down.
I try, Mother.
Well, that's all right. You just keep on trying. You're bound to succeed. Why, you're just full of natural endowments. Both my children are. You're very precious children. I've got an awful lot to be thankful for. But you must just promise me one thing.
What is it, Mother?
Promise me you're never going to become a drunkard.
I promise, Mother, I won't ever become a drunkard, Mother.
Well, that's what frightened me so, that you'd be drinking. Here, have a bowl of Purina.
Just coffee, Mother.
Shredded wheat biscuit.
No, Mother, just coffee.
Well, Well, you can't put in a day's work on an empty stomach. You've got 10 minutes. Now, don't go. Drinking two hot liquids makes cancer of the stomach. Put cream in.
No, thank you.
To cool it.
No, thank you. I want it black.
Well, I know you do, but it's not good for you. We have to do all we can to build ourselves up. In these trying times we live in, the only thing we have to cling to is each other. That's why it's so important. Tom, I sent out your sister so that I could discuss something with you. If you hadn't spoken, I would have spoken to you.
What is it, Mother, that you want to discuss?
Laura.
Oh. Laura.
You know how Laura is. So quiet, but still waters run deep. She notices things, and I think she broods about them. A few days ago, I came in, and she was crying.
What about?
You?
Me?
She has an idea you're not happy here.
What gave her that idea?
No, what gives her any idea? However, you do act strangely. No, I'm not criticizing. Understand that. I know that your ambitions do not lie in the warehouse. I know that, like everybody else in the whole wide world, you have had to make sacrifices. But Tom, life's not easy. It calls for Spartan endurance. There are so many things in my heart I cannot describe to you. I've never told you, but I loved your father.
I know that, Mother.
And you, when I see you taking after his ways, staying out late, and well, you had been drinking the night you were in that terrifying condition. Laura says you hate the apartment and that you go out nights to stay away from it. Is that true, Tom?
No. You say there's so much in your heart that you can't describe to me. Well, that's true of me, too. There's so much in my heart that I can't describe to you. So let's respect each other's privacy.
Tom, why are you always so restless? Where do you go to nights?
I go to the movies.
But why do you go to the movies so much, Tom?
I go to the movies because I like adventure. Adventure is something I don't have much of at work, so I go to the movies.
But Tom, you go to the movies entirely too much.
I like a lot of adventure.
Most young men find adventure in their careers.
Then most young men are not employed at a warehouse.
The world is full of young men employed in warehouses and offices and factories.
But do all of them find adventure in their careers?
They do, or they do without it. Not everybody has a craze for adventure.
Man is by instinct a lover, a hunter, a fighter, and none of those instincts are given much play at the warehouse.
Man is by instinct. Don't quote instinct to me. Instinct is something that people have got away from. It belongs to the animals. Christian adults don't want it.
What do Christian adults want then, Mother?
Superior things. Things of the mind and the spirit. Only animals need to satisfy instincts. Surely your aims are higher than theirs. Like monkeys or pigs.
I reckon they're not.
Oh, you're joking. However, that is not what I wanted to discuss.
I haven't much time.
Sit down!
You want me to punch in red the warehouse, Mother?
You have 5 minutes and I want to talk about Laura.
Right. What about Laura?
We have to be making some plans and provisions for her. She's older than you, 2 years, and nothing has happened. She just drifts along, doing nothing. It frightens me terribly how she just drifts along.
I guess she's a type that people call homegirls.
There is no such type, and if there is, it's a pity. Unless the home is hers with a husband.
What?
Oh, I can see the handwriting on the wall as plain as I see the nose in front of my face, and it is terrifying. More and more, you remind me of your father. He was out all hours without explanation, and then left. Goodbye. And me with a bag to hold. I saw that letter you got from the Merchant Marine. I know what you're dreaming of. I'm not standing here blindfolded. Very well, then. Then do it. But not until there's somebody to take your place.
What do you mean?
I mean that as soon as Laura has got somebody to take care of her, married, a home of her own, independent, then you'll be free to go wherever you please. On land, on sea, whichever way the wind blows you. But until that time, you have got to look out for your sister. I don't say me, because I'm old and don't matter. But I say your sister, because she is young and dependent. I put her in business college, but a dismal failure. Frightened her so it made her sick at the stomach. I took her over to the Young People's League at the church. Another fiasco. She spoke to nobody, nobody spoke to her. Now all she does is fool with those pieces of glass and play those worn out records. What kind of a life is that for a young girl to lead?
What can I do about it?
Overcome selfishness. Self, self, self is all you ever think of. Oh, where's your muffler? Put your wool muffler on. Oh, Tom, Tom! I haven't said what I had in mind to ask you.
I'm too late.
Oh, no, no, Tom, Tom, down at the warehouse. Aren't there some nice young men?
No!
Oh, there must be some.
Mother!
Find out one that's clean living and doesn't drink and ask him out for sister.
What?
For sister to me to get acquainted.
Oh, my gosh!
Will you? Will you? Will you, dear?
Yes!
Ella Cartwright? Ellie, it's Amanda Wingfield. Now first, how's that kidney trouble? Oh, it has. It has come back. Why, you're just a Christian martyr. You are just a Christian martyr. Well, I was noticing in my little red book that your subscription to The Companion is about to run out, just when that wonderful new serial by Bessie May Harper was starting. It's all about the horse, he said, on Long Island. Oh, you have read it. Well, how do you think it turns out? Oh, no, Bessie May Harper never lets you down. Well, of course we have to have complications. You have to have complications. We can't have a story without them. But Bessie May Harper always leaves you with such an uplift. What's the matter, Ella? You sound so mad. Oh, because it's 7 o'clock in the morning. I forgot, Ella, you never got up until 9. I forgot that anybody in the whole world was ever allowed to sleep as late as that. Well, I can't say any more than I'm sorry, can I? What? You will? You're gonna take that subscription from me anyhow? Oh, bless you, Ella. Bless you. Bless you.
Evenings in spring, they'd open the windows and doors, and the music came outside. outside. Sometimes they turn out all the lights except for a large glass sphere that hung from the ceiling. It would turn slowly about and filter the dust with delicate rainbow colors. And the orchestra would play a tango or a waltz. Someone had a slow and sensuous rhythm. The young couples would come outside to the relative privacy of the alley. You could see them kissing behind ash pits and telephone poles. This was compensation for lives that passed like mine, without change or adventure. Adventure and change were imminent this year, however. They were waiting around the corner for all these dancing kids, suspended in the mist of a Baptist garden, caught in the folds of Chamberlain's umbrella. In Spain, there was Guernica. Here, there was only hot swing music and dance halls and liquor, bars, and movies, and sex. It hung in the gloom like a chandelier, flooded all the world with brief, deceptive rainbows. While all these unsuspecting kids danced to Dear One, the world is waiting for the sunrise. All the world was really waiting for bombardments.
Tom, where are you?
I came out to smoke.
Oh, you smoke too much. A pack a day at 15 cents a pack. How much would that be in a month? 30 times 15. Well, it wouldn't be very much, but it would be enough to put towards a night school course in accounting at the Washington U. Now, wouldn't that be lovely?
I'd rather smoke.
Oh, I know. That is the tragedy of you. Oh, this fire escape landing is a poor excuse for the porch we used to have. What are you looking at?
The moon.
Is there a moon this evening?
It's rising over Garfinkel's delicatessen.
Oh, so it is. Such a little silver slip of moon. Mm-hmm. Have you made a wish?
Uh-huh.
What'd you wish?
Oh, that's a secret.
All right. I won't tell you what I wished for either. I can keep a secret, too. I can be just as mysterious as you.
Oh, I bet I can guess what you wished.
Why? Is my head transparent?
And you're not a sphinx.
No, I don't keep secrets. All right. I'll tell you what I wished for on the moon. I wish for success and happiness for my two precious children. I wish for that whenever there's a moon, and when there isn't a moon, I wish for two.
I thought perhaps you wished for a gentleman caller.
Why do you say that?
Don't you remember asking me to fetch one?
Well, I remember suggesting that it would be nice if you brought home some nice young man for your sister. I think I've made that suggestion more than once.
Yes, you've made it repeatedly.
Well?
We're gonna have one.
What?
Have a gentleman caller.
You mean you have invited some nice young boy to come over?
I've asked him to eat dinner.
You really did?
I did.
And did he accept?
He did.
He did?
He did.
Oh, isn't that lovely?
Oh. I thought that you would be pleased.
It's definite.
Oh, it was very definite.
How soon? How soon?
Quite soon.
How soon?
Very, very soon.
Oh, every time I want to know anything, you always start going on my back.
What do you want to know?
Go ahead and guess. Go ahead and guess.
All right, let me guess. You want to know when the gentleman call's coming? He's coming tomorrow.
Tomorrow? Oh, no. I can't do anything about tomorrow. I can't do anything about tomorrow.
Why not?
Well, but that doesn't give me enough time.
Time for what?
Time for preparations. Oh, you should have told me the minute you asked him. The minute he accepted.
You don't have to make any fuss.
Well, of course you have to make a fuss. You can't have a man coming into a place that's all sloppy. It's got to be thrown together properly. Oh, I certainly have some fast thinking to do by tomorrow night, too.
I don't see why you had to think at all.
Oh, that's because you don't know. You just don't know, that's all. You can't have a gentleman caller coming into a pigsty. Now, let's see. I've got those three pieces of wedding silver left. I can polish that up. And I wonder how that old damask tablecloth of Mama's is doing. We can't wear anything. We haven't got it. We haven't got anything to wear. We haven't got it.
Mother, this boy is no one to make a fuss over.
I don't know how you can say that when this is the first gentleman caller your sister has ever had. I think it's pathetic that that little girl has never had a single gentleman caller. Come on inside, come on inside.
What for?
I want to ask you some things.
If you're going to make a fuss, I'll call the whole thing off.
No!
I'll call the boy up and tell him not to come.
No, you mustn't do that. People hate broken engagements. They have no place to go. Come on inside, come on inside. Will you come inside when I ask you to come inside? Or sit down.
In a particular place?
You sit anywhere. Oh, look. Look. What am I going to do about that? I've never seen anything look so sad. I know, I know. I'll get a bright piece of cretonne. That won't cost much. And, I've been making payments on a floor lamp. I'll have that sent out. And let's see if I can get something out of here. Oh, dear. Oh, I wish I had time to paper the walls. What's his name?
His name is O'Connor.
O'Connor. That's Irish. Tomorrow's Friday. That means fish. That's okay. I can make a salmon loaf and some mayonnaise dressing for it. Where'd you meet him?
At the warehouse, of course. Where else would I meet him?
Well, I don't know. Does he drink?
Why did you ask me that?
Because your father did.
Don't get started on that.
Oh, he drinks then.
No, not that I know of.
Well, you have to find out. There is nothing I want less for my daughter than a man who drinks.
Mother, aren't you being a little bit premature? After all, poor Mr. O'Connor has not appeared upon the scene yet.
But he will tomorrow to meet your sister. And what do I know about his character?
Now, what are you up to?
I always did hate that Calic. I never could understand why it won't sit down by itself.
Mother, I want to tell you something I mean sincerely right straight from my heart. There's a lot of boys who meet girls which they don't marry.
You know, you always had me worried because you could never stick to a subject. Now, what is his position at the warehouse?
He's a shipping clerk.
Oh, a shipping clerk. Well, now that's fairly important. That's where you'd be if you had more getup. How much does he earn?
I have no way of knowing that for sure. I would judge his salary approximately $85 a month.
$85 a month. Well, that's not princely.
That's $20 more than I make.
Oh, I know that. How well I know that. How well I know that. $85. No, it can't be done. A family man can never get by on $85 a month.
Mother, Mr. O'Connor is not a family man.
Well, he might be sometime in the future, mightn't he?
I see. Plans and provisions.
You are the only young man I know who completely ignores the fact that the future becomes the present the past, and the past turns into everlasting regret unless you plan for it.
I shall think that over and see what I can make of it.
Don't you be supercilious with your mother. I want to know more about this Mr. O'Connor. Mr. O'Connor, what do you call him? You must have another name besides Mr.
His full name is James D. O'Connor. The D is for Delaney.
Delaney? Irish on both sides, and he doesn't drink?
Shall I call him up and ask him?
No! No!
I'll call him up and tell him you want to know if he drinks.
No. You must be discreet about that subject. When I was a girl in Blue Mountain, if it was suspected that a young man was drinking and any girl was receiving his attentions, if she was receiving his attentions, then she could go to the minister of his church and ask about his character. Or her father, if her father was still living, then it was his duty to go to the minister of the church and ask about his character. And that's how young girls in Blue Mountain were kept from making tragic mistakes.
How come you made such a tragic one?
Oh, I don't know. That face fooled everybody. All he had to do was grin and the world was bewitched. I can't think of anything more tragic than a young girl putting herself at the mercy of a handsome appearance. And I hope Mr. O'Connor is not too good looking.
As a matter of fact, he isn't. His face is covered with freckles and he has a very large nose.
Well, he's not right damn homely.
No, not light down homely, medium homely, I'd say.
Well, if a girl had any sense, she'd look the character in a man anyhow.
That's what I've always said, Mother.
That's what you've always said. That's what you've always said. How could you get those off there? How could you always have said it if you never even thought it?
Oh, don't be so suspicious of me.
I am suspicious of every word that comes out of your mouth when you talk to me. But I want to know more about this young man. Is he up and coming?
Yes. I really do think he goes in for self-improvement.
What makes you think it?
He goes to night school.
What does he do there at night school?
He studies radio engineering and public speaking.
Oh, public speaking. Oh, well, that shows that he intends to become an executive someday. And radio engineering? Well, that's coming, huh?
I think it's here.
Well, these are all very illuminating facts. Facts that every mother should know about any young man calling on her daughter, seriously or not.
Just one little warning, Mother. I didn't tell him anything about Laura. I didn't let on we had dark ulterior motives. I just said, how about coming home to dinner? And he said, fine, and that was the whole conversation.
I bet it was, too. I'll tell you, sometimes you can be as eloquent as an oyster. However, when that young man sees how sweet and pretty that child is, he's just gonna be very glad he was asked over here for some dinner.
Mother, just one thing. You won't expect too much of Laura, will you?
What do you mean?
Well, Laura seems all those things to you and me because she's ours and we love her. We don't even notice that she's crippled anymore.
Don't use that word.
Mother, you have to face the fact she is, and that's not all.
What do you mean that's not all?
Well, you know that Laura is very different from other girls.
Yes, I do know that, and I feel that difference is all in our favor, too.
Not quite all. In the eyes of others, strangers, Laura is terribly shy and lives in a world of her own, and those things make us seem a little peculiar, the people outside the house.
Don't use that word, peculiar.
Mother, you have to face the facts. She is.
I don't know in what way she is peculiar.
Mother, Laura lives in a world of little glass animals. She plays old phonograph records, and that's about all! So the following evening, I brought Jim home to dinner. I had known Jim slightly in high school. In high school, Jim was a hero. He had tremendous Irish good nature and vitality with the scrubbed and polished look of white chinaware. He seemed to move in a continual spotlight. He was a star in basketball, captain of the debating club, president of the senior class in the glee club, and he sang the male lead in the annual light opera. He was forever running, abounding, never just walking. He seemed always just at the point of defeating the law of gravity. He was shooting with such velocity through his adolescence that you would just logically expect him to arrive at nothing short of the White House by the time he was 30. But Jim apparently ran into more interference after his graduation from high school because his speed had definitely slowed. And so at this particular time in our lives, he was holding a job that wasn't much better than mine. He was the only one at the warehouse with whom I was on friendly terms. I was valuable to him as one who could remember his former glory, who had seen him win basketball games and the Silver Cup and debating. He knew of my secret practice of retiring to a cabin in the washroom to work on poems when business was slack at the warehouse. He called me Shakespeare. And while the other boys at the warehouse regarded me with suspicious hostility, Jim took a more humorous attitude toward me. Gradually, his attitude began to affect the other boys. And so, after a time, they began to smile at me too. People smile at some oddly fashioned dog that trots across their path at some distance. I knew Jim and Laura had known each other in high school because I had heard my sister Laura speak admiringly of Jim's voice. I didn't know if he would remember her or not, because in high school, Laura had been as unobtrusive as Jim had been astonishing. And if he did remember her, it was not as my sister. For when I asked him home to dinner, he smiled and said, "You know a funny thing, Shakespeare? I never thought of you as having folks." Well, he was about to discover that I did.
Why are you trembling so, Laura?
Mother, you've made me so nervous.
Well, why? How have I made you nervous?
By all this fuss, you make it seem so important.
I don't understand you at all, honey. Every time I try to do anything at all for you that's the least bit different, you seem to set yourself against it. Now, just look at yourself. Oh, wait a minute. I forgot something.
What is it?
A couple of improvements. When I was a girl, we had round little lacy things like that. We called them gay deceivers.
I don't wear them.
Well, of course you wear them.
Why should I?
Well, to tell you the truth, honey, you're just a tiny bit flat-chested.
You make it seem like we're setting a trap.
Well, we are. All pretty girls are traps, and men expect them to be traps. Yeah. Take a look at yourself in that glass. Oh, isn't that lovely? Look, you just look like an angel on a postcard. Now, you just wait a minute. I'm going to dress myself up. You are going to be astonished at your mother's appearance.
About to sing the sky. miles away. Come all to church, good people, come and pray. But hear my Lord's case. And I would turn and answer among the springing time. Oh, feel upon our wedding, and we will hear the
chime. Now, Laura, take a look at your mother now. Oh, no. Laura, come look at me now.
Mother, how lovely.
Oh, well. It used to be. It used to be. Oh, it had a lot of flowers on it, but they got awful tired, so I took them all off. Oh, I led the cotillion in this dress years ago. And I won the cakewalk twice at Sunset Hill. And I wore it to the governor's ball in Jackson. Mm. Oh, you should have seen your mother. You should have seen your mother. How she just sashayed around that ballroom floor just like that. Mm-hmm. Oh, I had it on the day I met your father. Had malaria fever, too. Change of climate from East Tennessee to the Delta just weakened my resistance. Not enough to be dangerous, but just enough to make me restless and giddy. Oh, it was lovely. Invitations poured in from all over. My mother said, you can't go anywhere, you have a fever, you have to stay in bed. And I said I wouldn't. And I took quinine and I just kept going and going. Oh, there were dances every evening and long carriage rides in the country in the afternoon and picnics. Oh, that country. That country so lovely in May, all lacy with dogwood and simply flooded with jonquils. My mother said, you can't bring any more jonquils into this house. And I said, I will, and I just kept on bringing them in anyhow. Whenever I saw them, I'd say, wait a minute, I see jonquils. And I'd make my gentleman callers get down out of the carriage and help me gather some. Actually, it got to be kind of a joke, Laura. Look out, they'd say, here comes that girl. We're gonna have to spend the whole afternoon picking jonquils. My mother said, you can't bring any more flowers into this house. We don't have any more vases to hold them. That's quite all right, I said. I'll hold some myself. Malaria fever. Your father and John's. Oh, my goodness. Oh, dear. I hope they get here before it starts to rain. I gave your brother a little extra change so he and Mr. O'Connor could take the service car home.
Mother?
What's the matter now?
What did you say his name was?
O'Connor. Why?
What's his first name?
Oh, I don't remember. Oh, yeah. Oh, yes, I do. It was Jim. That was it.
Oh, Mother, no, not Jim O'Connor.
Well, yes, that was it. It was Jim. I have never known a Jim who wasn't nice.
Are you sure his name was Jim O'Connor?
Well, sure. I'm sure. Why?
Is he the one that Tom used to know in high school?
Well, he didn't say so. I think he just got to know him down at the warehouse.
There was a Jim O'Connor we both knew in high school. Mother, if that's who Tom's bringing home to dinner, you'd have to excuse me. I wouldn't come to the table.
What is this? What sort of silly talk is this?
You asked me once if I ever liked a boy. Don't you remember? I showed you this boy's picture.
You mean that boy in the yearbook?
Yes, that boy.
Laura. Laura, were you in love with that boy?
I don't know, Mother. I just know I couldn't come to the table if it was him.
Well, it won't be him. Isn't the least bit likely. But whether it is or not, you will come to the table. You will not be excused.
I'll have to be, Mother.
Laura, I do not intend to humor your silliness. I haven't had enough with you and your brother both. Now you just sit down and compose yourself till they arrive. Your brother has forgotten his key, so you'll have to let them in when they come.
Oh, no, Mother. You answer the door.
How can I when I haven't even finished making the mayonnaise dressing for the salmon?
Mother, please, you answer it. Don't make me do it.
Oh, honey, do be reasonable. What is all this fuss over just one gentleman gala? That's all. Just one. Laura, sweetheart, the door.
Mother, you go to the door.
The matter silly thing.
Please, please, you answer it, please.
Why have you chosen this moment to lose your senses? Now you go to that door.
I can't.
Why can't
because
you?
Because I'm sick.
You're sick. Am I sick? You and your brother have me puzzled to death. You can never act like normal children. Now will you give me one good reason why you should be afraid to open a door? Now you walk to that door, Laura Winfield. You march straight to that door.
Yes, Mother.
I've got to put courage in you, honey, for living.
Jim, this is my sister, Laura.
I didn't know that Shakespeare had a sister. How are you, Laura?
How do you do?
Well, I'm okay. Your hand's cold, Laura.
Yes, well, I've been playing the vitrola.
Ah, you must have been playing classical music on it. You ought to play a little hot swing music on it. Warm you up.
What's the matter?
Oh, Laura's... He's terribly shy.
Oh, shy girl, huh? You know, it's unusual nowadays to meet a shy girl. I don't believe you ever mentioned you had a sister.
Well, now you know I have one. You want a piece of paper?
Yeah.
Comics.
Sports. See, old Busy Dean is on his bad behavior.
Yeah.
So where are you going?
Out here, smoke.
You know, Shakespeare, I'm going to sell you a bill of goods.
What bill?
A course I'm taking.
What course?
A course in public speaking. You know, you and me, we're not the warehouse type.
Thanks, that's good news, but what's public speaking got to do with it?
It fits you for executive positions.
Oh.
I tell you, it's done a hell of a lot for me.
In what respect?
In all respects. So ask yourself, what's the difference between you and me and the guys in the office down front? Brains? No. Ability? No. Then what? Primarily, it amounts to just one single thing.
What is that one thing?
Social poise. The ability to square up to somebody and hold your own at any social level.
Tom?
Yes, Mother?
Is that you and Mr. O'Connor?
Yes, Mother.
Well, make yourselves comfortable.
We will.
Ask Mr. O'Connor if he would like to wash his hands.
Oh, no thanks, ma'am. I took care of that down at the warehouse.
Tom?
Mr. Mendoza was speaking to me about you.
Favorably.
What do you think?
Well...
You're going to be out of a job if you don't wake up.
I'm waking up.
Yeah, but you show no signs.
The signs are interior. I'm just about to make a change. I'm not at the point of committing myself to a future that doesn't include the warehouse or Mr. Mendoza, or even a night school course in public speaking.
And now what are you gassing about?
I'm tired of the movies.
The movies?
Yes, movies. Look at them, all those glamorous people having adventures, hogging and all, gobbling the whole thing up. You know what happens? People go to the movies instead of moving. Hollywood characters are supposed to have all the adventures for everyone in America, while everyone in America sits in a dark room and watches them having it. Yes, until there's a war. That's when adventure becomes available to the masses. Everyone's dish, not only Gables, and the people in the dark room come out of the dark room to have some adventures for themselves. Goody, goody, it's our turn now to make a safari, to be exotic, far off. But I'm not patient. I don't want to wait till then. I'm tired of the movies. I'm about to move.
Move?
Yes.
When?
Soon.
Where? Where?
I'm starting to boil inside. I know I seem dreamy, but well, inside I'm boiling. Whenever I pick up a shoe, I shudder a little, thinking how short life is and what I'm doing. Whatever that means, I know it doesn't mean shoes. Except it's something to wear on a traveler's feet. Look.
What?
I'm a member.
A union of merchant seamen.
I paid my dues this month. Instead of an electric light bill.
You regret it when they turn the lights off.
I won't be here.
Yeah, but how about your mother?
I'm like my father, the bastard son of a bastard, and he's been absent going on 16 years.
Ah, you're just talking. Dread.
But how does your mother feel about this?
Shh!
Here one, the world is waiting for the Tom?
Yes, Mother?
Where are you all?
Out on the terrace, Mother.
Well, why don't you come on in?
Mother, you look so pretty.
Do you know that is the first compliment you have ever paid me? I wish you'd look pleasant when you're about to say something pleasant so I could expect it. You still calm?
How do you do, ma'am?
Well, well, well. So this is Miss Jocona. Introduction's entirely unnecessary. I have heard so much about you from my boy that I finally said, Tom, why don't you bring this paragon to supper finally? I'd like to meet this nice young man from the warehouse instead of just hearing you sing his praises so much. I don't know why my son is so standoffish. That's not Southern hospitality. Let's sit down. Sit down. Oh, I think we could use a little more air in here. Tom, would you open the door, please? I felt a nice fresh breeze a moment ago. Where has it gone to? So warm already and not quite summer even. We're gonna burn up when summer really gets started. However, we are having a very light supper this evening. I think light things are better for this time of year. The same as light clothes are. Light food and light clothes are what the warm weather calls for. You know, our blood gets so thick during the winter that it takes us a while to adjust ourselves when the season changes. Came so quick this year, I wasn't prepared. All of a sudden, heavens, summer already. Oh, I ran to the trunk and I pulled out this light dress. It's terribly old. Historical, almost. But it feels so good, you know, so good and cool.
Mother, how about our supper?
Well, honey, why don't you go ask Sister supper's ready? You know that Sister's in full charge of supper. You just tell her you hungry boys are waiting for it. Have you met Laura?
Oh, well, she came to the door, ma'am.
She let you in?
Yes, ma'am.
She's very pretty.
Yes, ma'am.
You know, it's rare for a girl as sweet and pretty as Laura to be domestic, but Laura is, thank heavens, not only pretty, but also very domestic. I'm not at all. I never was a bit. I can't make a thing but angel food cake. Well, we had so many servants in the South. Gone, gone, gone. All vestige of gracious living, just gone completely. I wasn't prepared for what the future brought me. All of my gentlemen callers were sons of planters, and I naturally assumed that I would be married to one and live on a large piece of land, raise my family with plenty of servants. But man proposes and woman accepts proposal, to vary that old saying a bit. I married no planter. I married a man who worked for the telephone company. That gallantly smiling gentleman over there. Telephone man fell in love with long distance. And now he travels, I don't even know where. Oh, but What am I going on for about my tribulations? You tell me yours. I hope you don't have any. Tom?
Yes, Mother?
How about that supper?
Why, supper is on the table.
Oh, why, so it is. Isn't that lovely? Where is Laura?
Laura's not feeling too well. Thinks maybe she better not come to the table.
Laura?
Yes, Mother?
Mr. O'Connor. Laura, honey, we can't say grace until you come to the table. Is Laura all right now?
She's better, Mom.
Oh, my goodness, I suppose we're going to have some rain. Tom, you say grace.
What?
What do we generally do before we sit down to have something to eat? We say grace, don't we?
These and all thy mercies, God's holy name be praised.
Mr. Leibold?
Oh, where was Moses when the lights went out? Do you know the answer to that one, Mr. O'Connor?
No, ma'am. What's the answer to that one?
Well, I heard one answer, but it wasn't very nice. I thought you might know another one.
No, ma'am.
Well, it's lucky that I put these candles on the table. I put them on just for ornamentation, but it's nice when they prove useful, too.
Yes, ma'am.
Now, if one of you gentlemen can provide me with a match, we can have some illumination.
Can, ma'am?
It's in the kitchen, but be careful, it's dark in there. Don't stumble over anything.
Ow.
Oh, my goodness, wouldn't it be awful if we lost her? Mr. O'Connor, are you all right?
Oh, I'm all right, ma'am.
Oh, you know, electricity is a very mysterious thing. The whole universe is mysterious to me. Wasn't it Benjamin Franklin who tied a key to a kite? I'd like to have seen that. It might look mighty silly. You know, some people say that science clears up all the mysteries for us, but in my opinion, it just keeps on adding more. Haven't you found it yet?
Well, yes, ma'am. I found them all right, but the fuses look okay to me.
Tom.
Yes, Mother.
That light bill I gave you several days ago, the one I got the notice about?
Oh, yeah, you mean last month's bill.
You didn't neglect it by any chance?
Well, I...
You did. I might have known better than to trust you with it.
Oh, Shakespeare probably wrote a poem on that light bill, Miss Winfield.
Oh, maybe he did, too. I should never have trusted him with it. There's such a high price for negligence in this world today.
The poem will win a $10 prize.
Well, we'll just have to spend the rest of the evening in the 19th century before Mr. Edison found that master light.
Well, candlelight is my favorite kind of light.
Well, now that shows you're romantic. But that is no excuse for Tom. I think it was very nice of them to let us finish our dinner in peace before plunging us into everlasting darkness. Thomas, penalty for your carelessness. Who can help you with the dishes?
Oh, can I be of some help, Anne?
Oh, no, I couldn't allow that.
Well, I ought to be good for something.
What did I hear?
I just said I ought to be good for something.
I thought that's what you said. Well, Laura is still by her lonesome out front. Perhaps she'd like to keep her company. I can give you this lovely old candelabra for light. It used to be on the altar of the Church of the Heavenly Rest. It got melted a little out of shape and the church burnt down one spring. The church was struck by lightning, and Gypsy Jones, who was holding a revival meeting in the village, said that the reason the church was struck by lightning was because the Episcopalians had started to hold card parties right in the church.
Is that so?
Oh, I never say anything that isn't so.
I beg your pardon.
And I'd like Laura to have a little dandelion wine. Do you think you can hold both?
I can try.
Tom, you can get into your apron.
Yes, ma'am.
How are you feeling? Any better?
Yes, thank you.
Oh, wow. Here, this is for you. It's a little dandelion wine.
Thank you.
Well, drink it, but don't get drunk. Say, where'll I set the candles?
Oh, anywhere.
Oh, how about right here on the floor? You got any objections?
No.
Spread this old newspaper under and catch the drippings. Well, you know, I like to sit on the floor. Do you mind if I do?
Oh, no.
Would you give me a pillow?
What?
Pillow. How about you? Don't you like to sit on the floor?
Oh, yes.
Well, why don't you?
I will.
All right. Take a pillow. Well, I can't see you sitting way over there.
I can see you.
I know. That's not fair. I'm right here in the limelight. Now I can see you. Say, are you comfortable?
Yes, thank you.
So am I. I'm comfortable as a cow. Say, would you care for a stick of chewing gum?
No, thank you.
Oh, well, I think I will indulge. You know, you think of the fortune made by the guy that invented the first piece of chewing gum. It's amazing, huh? You know, the Wrigley Building is one of the sights of Chicago. I saw it summer before last when I went up for the Century of Progress. Did you take in the Century of Progress?
No, I didn't.
Oh, well,
It was a wonderful exposition, believe me. You know what impressed me most? Huh? The hall of science. Gives you an idea of what the future will be like in America, I tell you. It's more wonderful than the present time is. Say, your brother tells me you're shy. Is that right, Laura?
I don't know.
I judge you to be an old-fashioned type of girl, and I think that's a wonderful type to be.
Say, I hope you don't think I'm being too personal, do you?
Mr. O'Connor, I believe I will take a piece of gum, if you don't mind. Mr. O'Connor.
Hmm?
Have you kept up with your singing?
Singing? Me?
Yes, I remember what a beautiful voice you had.
You heard me sing?
Yes, very often. I don't suppose you remember me at all?
You know, I did have an idea. I seen you somewhere before. You know, it seemed almost like I was about to remember your name, but the name I was about to remember wasn't the name, so I stopped myself before I said it.
Wasn't it Blue Roses?
Blue Roses. My gosh, yes, Blue Roses! Oh, I didn't connect you with high school somehow or other, but that's where it was high school. Gee, I didn't know you were Shakespeare's sister.
I didn't expect you to. You barely knew me.
But we did have a speaking acquaintance.
Yes, we spoke to each other.
Say, didn't we have a class in something together?
Yes, we did.
What class was that?
It was singing, chorus.
Oh.
I sat across the aisle from you in the auditorium, Mondays, Wednesdays, and Fridays.
I remember now. You're the one who always came in late.
Yeah, it was so hard for me getting up the stairs, and I had a brace on my leg then, and it clumped so loud.
Never heard any clumping.
To me, it sounded like thunder.
I never even noticed.
You know, everybody was seated before I came in, and I had to walk in front of all those people. My seat was in the back row, and I had to go clumping up the aisle with everyone watching.
Gee, I shouldn't have been self-conscious.
I know, but I was. It was always such a relief when the singing started.
I remember now. I used to call you Blue Roses? How did I ever get started calling you a name like that?
I was out of school a while with pleurosis, and when I came back, you asked me what was the matter, and I said pleurosis, and you thought I said Blue Roses. So that's what you always called me after that.
Oh, you didn't mind.
Oh, no, I liked it. You see, I wasn't acquainted with many people.
Yeah, I remember. You sort of stopped by yourself.
I never did have much luck at making friends.
I don't see why you wouldn't.
Well, I started out badly.
Oh, you mean being,
Yeah, it sort of stood between me and...
Well, you shouldn't have let it.
I know, but it did, and...
You mean you were shy with people?
I tried not to be, but never could.
Overcome it?
No, I never could.
Yeah. I guess being shy is something you have to work your way out of, kind of gradually. Hmm?
Yeah, I guess it takes time.
Thank you.
So you know something, Laura.
Other people are not so dreadful when you know them.
That's what you have to remember, and boy, everybody has problems. Not just you. Practically everybody has some problems, and you think of yourself being the only one who's disappointed. But you take a look around you, and what do you see? A lot of people just as disappointed as you are. Well, take me, for instance. Boy, when I finished high school, I thought I'd be a lot further along at this time than I am now. You remember that wonderful write-up I had in the Torch?
Yes, I do.
I said I was bound to succeed in anything I went into. Holy cheese, the Torch.
Look, here you are in the Pirates of Penzance.
The Pirates?
Oh, better far to live and die, under the brave black flag I fly.
Sang the lead in that operetta.
So beautifully. Yes, yes, beautifully, beautifully.
You heard me then, huh?
I heard you all three times.
No.
Oh. Yes.
You mean all three performances?
Yeah, yes.
What for?
I wanted to ask you to autograph my program.
Oh, why didn't you ask me?
Well, you were always surrounded by your own friends.
You should have just come right up and said, here.
No, I thought you might think I was...
Tom, I think he was...
What?
Oh.
Oh. Yeah, I was beleaguered by females in those days.
You were terribly popular.
Yeah.
You had such a friendly way.
I was spoiled in high school.
Everybody liked you.
Including you.
Yes, I did too.
Give me that program, Laura. There you go.
My.
Better late than never.
What a surprise.
My signature is not worth very much right now, but someday, maybe, it will increase in value. You see, being disappointed is one thing. Being discouraged is something else. Well, I may be disappointed, but I'm not discouraged. Say, you finished high school.
I made bad grades on my final examinations.
You mean you dropped out?
I didn't go back.
That crowdhead?
Why do you call her that?
Because that's what she was.
You're not still going with her?
Oh, I never even see her.
But it said in the personal section that you were engaged.
I know, but I wasn't impressed by that propaganda.
It wasn't the truth?
It was only true in Emily's optimistic opinion. So what have you been doing since high school?
What?
I said, what have you been doing since high school?
Nothing much.
Well, you must have been doing something all this time.
Yes.
Well then, such as what?
I took a business course at business college.
Oh, you did? Oh, how'd that work out?
Not very well. I had to drop out.
It gave me indigestion.
So what are you doing now?
I don't do anything much. Please don't think I sit around doing nothing. My glass collection takes up a good deal of time. Glass is something you have to take good care of.
What was that you said about glass?
Collection, I said. I have one.
Do you know what I judge to be the trouble with you, Laura? Inferiority complex. Do you know what that is? That's what they call it when a fellow low rates himself. Oh, I understand, because I had it too.
Uh-huh.
Only my case was not as aggravated as yours seems to be. I had it till I took up public speaking, developed my voice, and learned that I have an aptitude for science. Do you know, till that time, I never thought of myself as being outstanding in any way whatsoever.
Oh, my.
Now, I've never made a regular study argument or nothing, but I have a friend who says I can analyze people better than doctors that make a profession of it. I don't claim that to be necessarily true, but I sure can guess a person's psychology. Excuse me, Laura. I'll just take it out when the flavor's gone. Just wrap it in a piece of paper. You know how it is when you get it stuck on a shoe. That's what I judge to be your principal trouble, a lack of confidence in yourself as a person. Now, I'm basing that fact on a number of observations and on certain of your remarks. For example, that clumping you always thought was so awful in high school. You say you even dreaded to go upstairs. Do you see what you did? You gave up an education. You dropped out of school. All because of a little clump. Which, far as I can see, is practically non-existent. A little physical defect is all you have. Hardly noticeable even, magnified 1,000 times by your imagination. You know what my strong advice to you is? You've got to think of yourself as superior in some way.
In what way would I think?
Why, man alive, Laura, just take a look around you. What do you see? A world full of common people, all of them born, and all of them gonna die. Now, which one of them has 1/10 of your strong points? Or mine, or anyone else's for that matter? You see, boy, everybody excels in some one thing. Well, some in many. You take me, for instance. My interest happens to lie in electrodynamics. I'm taking a night school course in radio engineering, on top of a very responsible job at the warehouse. I'm taking that course, and I'm studying public speaking.
My!
Because I believe in the future of television. You see, I want to be ready to go right up along with it. I've already made the right connections. I'm getting on the ground floor. All that remains now is for the industry itself to get underway, you know? You know, with knowledge, money, power, buy more! Well, that's the cycle democracy's built on. Guess you must think I think a lot of myself.
No, I don't.
Well, what about you? Isn't there some one thing you take more interest in than anything else?
Yes!
Well then, such as what?
Well, I do, as I said, have my glass collection.
You do? Well, what kind of glass is it?
It's little articles of it, and ornaments mostly. They're animals. The tiniest little animals in the world. Mother calls it a glass menagerie. Here's an example of one if you'd like to see it. This is one of the oldest. It's nearly 13. Be careful. If you breathe, it breaks.
Oh, I'd better not take him. I'm clumsy with things.
Oh, go on. I trust you with him. him over the line. He loves the line. See how the light shines through it?
Oh, it sure does shine.
Some horses that don't have horns, and they all seem to get along nicely together.
They do, huh? Say, where did I set
him? Put him on the table. They all like a change of scenery once in a while.
Look how big my shadows when it's stretch.
Wow, it stretches across the wall.
Oh.
Stop raining. Where does the music come from?
From the Paradise Dance Hall across the alley.
How about cutting the rug a little, Miss Winfield? Or is your program off? Don't let that. Let me take
it. Oh, say, every dance is taken. I'll just have to scratch some back.
Oh, a foxtrot.
I can't dance.
Ah, there you go, that inferiority stuff again.
I've never danced in my life.
Come on, try.
But I'd step on you.
Well, I'm not made out of glass.
Oh. he's just like all the other horses.
Oh, you mean he's lost his...
He's lost his horn. It doesn't matter. Maybe it's a blessing in disguise.
Ah, I'll bet you'll never forgive me. I bet that was your favorite piece of glass.
Oh, I don't have favorites. Much. It's no tragedy. Glass breaks so easily, no matter how careful you are. The traffic jars the shelves and things fall off them.
Still, I'm awfully sorry I was the cause of it.
I'll just imagine he had an operation. The horn was removed to make him feel less freakish. Now he'll feel more at home with the other horses, the ones who don't have horns.
Yeah, I'm glad you have a sense of humor. You know, you're very different from anybody else I know. Do you mind me saying that? I mean it. You made me feel sort of... Don't know how to say it. Usually pretty good at expressing things, but this is something I don't know how to say. Has anyone ever told you you were pretty? Because you are. And in a different way from anybody else, too, and all the nicer, too, because of the difference. I wish you were my sister. I'd teach you to have some confidence in yourself. Being different, nothing to be ashamed of. Because other people are not such wonderful people. They're 100 times 1,000. You're 1 times 1. They walk all over the earth. You just stay here. They're common as weeds, but you're blue roses.
Blue is wrong for roses.
It's right for you. You're... pretty.
In what respect am I pretty?
In all respects. Your eyes. Your hair. Your hands are pretty. You think I'm saying all this just because I'm invited over for dinner and I have to be nice. So I could do that. I could say a lot of things without being very sincere, but I'm speaking to you. Sincerely, I have to notice that you had this inferiority complex that keeps you from feeling comfortable with people. Well, somebody ought to take you and build your confidence up, way up, and make you proud instead of shy and turning away and blushing. And somebody ought to kiss you. Would you care for a cigarette?
You don't smoke, do you?
peppermint. Lifesaver. My pocket's a regular drugstore. You know, Laura, if I had a sister like you,
I'd do what Tom's been doing. I'd bring fellows home to meet you. Oh, maybe I shouldn't be saying that. I mean, maybe that's not the idea in having me over, but... what if it is? Nothing wrong with that. Only thing is, in my case, I'm not in a position to... I can't ask for your number. I can't call you up and ask for a date. I can't call next weekend. I thought I should explain the situation in case you misunderstood and I hurt your feelings.
You won't call again?
No, Laura, I can't. See, as I was just explaining, I've got strings on me. I've been going steady. I go out all the time with a girl named Betty. Oh, she's a nice, quiet homegirl like you, and Irish, and Catholic, and in a great many ways, we get along fine. We met on a moonlit boat trip up the river last summer on the Majestic. Well, whew, right from the start, it was love. Being in love has made a new man out of me. I mean, power of love is really pretty tremendous. Love is something that changes the whole world. It happened that Betty's aunt took sick. She got a wire and had to go to Centralia. So, naturally, when Tom invited me over for dinner, well, naturally, I just accepted the invitation. Not knowing that, I mean that, not knowing.
I wish that you would say something.
What are you doing that for? You want me to have them? What for?
A souvenir.
I'm coming, children. I thought you might want to have some liquid refreshment. Mr. O'Connor, do you know that song about lemonade? Lemonade, lemonade, stir it made in the shade and stir it with a spade, till then it's good enough for any old maid.
Oh, ma'am, I hadn't heard that one.
Oh, why are you so serious, honey?
Oh, well, we were having a serious conversation.
Oh, I don't understand you modern young people. When I was young, I was gay about everything.
You haven't changed a bit, Miss Wingfield.
Well, I guess it's the gaiety of the occasion that has rejuvenated me. Let's drink to the gaiety of the occasion, sweetheart. Here's to the gaiety of the occasion. Oops, I baptized myself. I found some cherries in the kitchen. I put one in each glass.
Oh, you shouldn't have gone to any trouble, ma'am.
Oh, it was no trouble at all. Didn't you hear us cutting up in the kitchen? I was so outdone with Tom for not bringing you over sooner. But now that you've found your way, I want you to come back all the time. Not just once in a while, but all the time. Oops, I think I better go back into that kitchen.
Oh, no, ma'am, don't go. Please, don't go. Matter of fact, I have to be going.
Oh, but Mr. O'Connor, it's just the shank of the evening.
Oh, I know, but, you know how it is.
You mean you're a young working man and you have to keep working men's hours.
That's it.
Well, we'll let you go early this time, but only on the condition that you stay much later next time. What night is best for you, Mrs. Saturday?
Well, ma'am, as a matter of fact, I have two time clocks to punch, one in the daytime and another in the evening.
Oh, isn't that nice? You're
so ambitious. You work at night, too?
Oh, well, no, ma'am, not work, but Betty.
Betty? Who's Betty?
Oh, just a girl. Girl I go steady with.
Babe, you mean it's serious?
Yes, ma'am, we're going to be married second Sunday in June.
Tom didn't mention anything about you or going to be married.
Oh, well, cat's not out of the bag at the warehouse yet. You know how it is, they call it Romeo, stuff like that. Well, thank you, ladies, for a wonderful evening. I guess this is what they mean by Southern hospitality.
Oh, it was nothing, nothing at all.
Hope it don't seem like I'm rushing off, but I promised Betty I'd meet her train at 9. By the time I get my jalopy down to the old Wabash Depot, why, that train will be in. You know how some women hate to be kept waiting.
Yes, I know all about the tyranny of women. Good night, Mr. O'Connor. I wish you happiness and good fortune. You wish that for him too, don't you, Laura?
Yes, yes, I do, Mother.
Goodbye, Laura. I'll always treasure that souvenir you gave me. And don't you forget that good advice I gave you. So long, Shakespeare. Well, thanks again, ladies. Good night.
Well, well, well. Things have a way of turning out so badly. I don't believe I would play the Victrola. Well, well, well. So our gentleman caller was engaged to be married. Tom?
Yes, Mother?
Come on out here. I want to tell you something very funny.
Has the gentleman caller gotten away already?
The gentleman caller made a very early departure. That was a nice joke you played on us, too.
How do you mean?
You didn't tell us he was engaged to be married.
Jim engaged?
That's what he just informed us.
I'll be jiggered. I didn't know.
That seems very peculiar.
What's peculiar about it?
Didn't you tell me he was your best friend down at the warehouse?
He is, but how would I know?
It seems very peculiar that you wouldn't know your best friend was engaged to be married.
The warehouse is the place where I work, not where I know things about people.
You don't know things about anywhere. You live in a dream. You manufacture illusions. Where are you going? Where are you going? Where are you going?
I'm going to the movies.
Oh, that's right. Now that you've had us make such fools of ourselves. All the effort, the preparations, the expense. The new floor length, the clothes for Laura. All for what? To entertain some other girl's fiancé. Just go to the movies, go. Don't think about us. A mother deserted. An unmarried sister who's crippled and has no job.
Oh!
Don't let anything interfere with your selfish pleasure. Just go, go, go!
All right, I will! And the more you shout about my selfish pleasure, the quicker I'll go. And I won't go to the movies either.
Go then! Then go to the moon, you selfish dreamer!
Oh.
I didn't go to the moon. I went much further. For time is the longest distance between two places. Not long after that, I was fired for writing a poem on the lid of a shoebox. I left St. Louis. I descended the steps of this fire escape for a last time and traveled from then on in my father's footsteps, attempting to find in motion what was lost in space. I traveled around a great deal. The cities swept about me like dead leaves, leaves that were brightly colored, but torn away from the branches. I would have stopped, but I was pursued by something. It always came upon me unawares, taking me altogether by surprise. But perhaps it was a familiar bit of music. Perhaps it was only a piece of colored glass. Perhaps I'm walking along a street at night in some strange city before I found companions. I passed the lighted window of a shop where perfume is sold. The window is filled with pieces of colored glass. Tiny transparent bottles in delicate colors like bits of a shattered rainbow. Then, all at once, my sister touches my shoulder. I turn around and look into her eyes.
Oh, Laura, I tried to leave you behind me, but I'm more faithful than I intended to be. I reach for a cigarette, I cross the street, I run into the movies or a bar, I buy a drink, I speak to the nearest stranger. Anything that can blow your candles out. For nowadays, the world is lit by lightning. So, goodbye.